Hello and welcome to This Is. Today we're going to talk about all the things we've talked about already with the Xbox, except in a little bit more detail.
Thank you for subscribing to This Is, by the way. So, this is the official lift of the preview embargo of the Series X. So previously, up until this point, there was a lot of stuff that we couldn't talk about that was still being tested. And to be fair, this is still prototype hardware. This is not the final retail Series X, although I will say it is very close, but little bugs, minor things are still around.
We got an early, this is 99.9% what you're gonna get in a retail package. Yeah. So it's not like there's gonna be night and day difference.
Yeah.
The first thing we can unveil is the UI, which I'm disappointed by. I have never liked Xbox's UI. I think it's just so cluttered for no reason whatsoever. The games and apps page is what I think should be the default homepage. And I was really hoping that they cleaned it up. It is somehow worse this generation. So that's my big ding on the Series X.
I will say the Xbox Series X from a software perspective is very much an evolution of the Xbox One in a lot of ways. Part of that is because obviously you have like that backwards compatibility, a lot of that stuff. I don't want to say it's built in because obviously I know with that compatibility team, they've put a lot of work into it, but a lot of that is very similar. I'm not massively surprised. The interface of the Series X is very, very similar to the Xbox One. There are improvements. It does run at 120 FPS.
So I'm not someone who usually cares about like anything past 60. You know, like if you hit 60 for me, I'm pretty happy. It is nice to seeing the snappiness of the 120.
But the thing is,
it's 120 hertz of going through unnecessary pages on the UI.
Yeah, and also the thing is, the way that the Xbox UI is designed, it's not full of very fluid animations like boom, boom, boom. Yeah. So you can technically see, or supposedly it's running at 120 FPS. To be fair, I actually haven't run it through a high-speed camera to ensure that, because it's very difficult for us right now to record anything at 120 FPS.
Yeah, we gotta call Gavin for that.
I will say, if you're expecting a major upgrade on the UI, it is very similar to what you get on the Xbox One. In fact, I think a lot of what's on the Series X is already on the insider ring of the Xbox One.
Yeah, it's really, I mean, yeah?
It's similar. Like
it's very similar. Yeah. It looks like a slightly darker theme than what you're currently used to.
I changed the theme.
Well, okay, he changed the theme. I didn't see that. I thought that was the default.
One of the other things, though, that after spending some real time with this is becoming more and more apparent is that high frame rate's not just a fluke. So we have access to a few games. So essentially, as developers are getting their games ready, we're able to get like kind of early preview codes. Again, big grain of salt. All of these things are still in progress. They're not done. We run into bugs and stuff. That's totally normal for a game that's not finished. So a couple of the games that I have been playing, Gears 5. So this is something that we got to take a look at back in March. It runs, just a quick recap, it runs at 4K, 60 FPS, above PC Ultra spec. So looks great in the campaign.
It looks amazing.
Very, very nice. I mean, there's like a few places where you can see like low res textures that kind of make it seem a little old, but the graphics, frame rate, everything looks good, right? Now, when you get into multiplayer, you actually get a 120 FPS option. Very cool.
We didn't play because there's, well, no one else playing multiplayer.
We're so lonely.
Yeah, that's just part of the problem of having early hardware, but I'm assuming that's locked at 1080.
I don't believe it's the full 4K Ultra spec. I think that you're sacrificing somewhat. It may be dynamic, but
dynamic
I do think it's closer to 4K than it is like something like 1080. I do know that the Xbox Series S runs at 1080p, 120 FPS in multiplayer, but I think the Series X is somewhere north of that.
I would be surprised if maybe like 1440, but I would be surprised if it's doing full 4K 120 on multiplayer.
You say that, I think there's still headroom in this, right? They threw all of the Ultra spec at it, right? So compared to the PC, they threw all the Ultra spec, they threw some extra stuff on top, and it runs at a pretty stable 4K 60. So I wouldn't be surprised if there actually is some headroom. So when you throw it at 120 FPS, it's not crazy difficult to run. Now, beyond that, we've also been playing some Dirt 5, which, side note, just a really fun game. But with Dirt 5, you have a few options as well. So you have the better quality mode. I think they actually called something else. But essentially, there's quality, there's performance mode. Quality seems to be pretty much locked at 4K. You get like improved texture filtering, some other stuff like that. As you go down to the frame rate optimized mode, I couldn't tell a huge difference between the two as far as performance goes.
So performance, I didn't notice a huge difference, but you did see, I mean, I'm really bad at that game. And so I went, even though it's an off-road game, if you went too far off-road, so I think I hit like a cornfield.
Oh, it resets
like,
you, yeah.
Yeah, well, like, as soon as you strayed a little bit, that's when you really saw the textures kind of really fall apart in the performance
there's
mode.
Actually a third mode. So you are playing on the 120p mode. So the way that it works is that inside the Xbox UI, you can switch the frame rate now. So you see 60 and 120 as well as the resolution. So fun little fact, if you're playing on an HDMI 2.1 capable TV, and we're gonna definitely do a video on this, probably on the main channel soon, as far as the best TVs and displays to get. But if you're playing on a display that can handle 4K 120, you flip to 120, it's fine. However, I was playing at home on my slightly older LG OLED, and when I switched to 120, it automatically dropped the resolution to 1080p.
Which I think is a really nice feature for those who, it's confusing to figure out what has HDMI 2.1, what has 4K 120. I was looking on Best Buy the other day. Literally none of the TVs actually list what their HDMI ports are in
specs.
That's
important.
And that's something that Best Buy is going to 100% have to just revamp their entire site to. That's a huge spec to have.
Yeah.
You know, this console generation.
But it is nice that you don't have to necessarily have a crazy expensive TV to get 120 FPS, because a lot of TVs will run at 1080p 120, which might not be ideal, but if it's me, I'm taking the higher frame rate over the slightly more detail.
Well, and that's one of the things we talked about when we were first looking at this is, you know, is anyone actually going to benefit from this right out of the box?
So far.
And so it shows that, even if you don't have a great TV, you are going to benefit from this day one with the optimized game.
Yes, but I think beyond just the pure frame rate, I think that actually tells a bigger story for what we have right now. What we don't have is a Halo Infinite or a true dedicated next-gen title for the Series X.
To be fair, neither does PlayStation, but...
Well, I'm saying we don't even have it like in our hands, much less something that's coming out. But one of the things that is very apparent...
I was gonna say the closest thing is probably Cyberpunk.
But that's a cross-gen title.
It's a cross-gen title, but that's the closest thing to any, for any console, for anything next gen
not seen anything that really flexes the ray tracing capabilities of the Series X, for example. That being said, I think one of the big takeaways so far for me personally is the speed of the console generally. Because let's not forget, with the Xbox One and PS4, they were running very slow CPUs, right? So just the fact that you have a dedicated standard SSD and much faster CPUs, which is roughly equivalent to like a Ryzen 7, that by itself means that everything is faster. Loading menus, getting into games significantly faster, everything just feels so snappy.
I was thinking about the load times, because we'll talk about that in a second, but spoilers, they're faster.
Yeah.
So I always use like the metric of like, when am I gonna stop playing a game?
Yeah.
There's always, all right, I died. Do I feel like waiting for the game to reload again?
Yeah.
And if I don't feel like waiting for that load time, I guess I'm done playing for the night. But now when we're talking, it's a few seconds to load, I'm going to be playing games forever.
It's one of those things where when you get, and this is, I'm almost positive, going to be the same story for PS5 as well, right? When you get a next-gen console, you're going to see PC-like load times. In fact, in some scenarios, actually faster than a lot of PCs. But you're going to get used to it really quick, I guess. And it's one of those things where once you play it for a little bit, like, whatever, it doesn't matter. But then you step back to an Xbox One or PS4 and you go, oh my God, I can't believe I used to sit around for 2 minutes and watch Red Dead load, right? It's a major difference.
It is a night and day difference. And so then we can talk about, we saw the PS5 teardown. We saw how they're doing their SSD, which is one you can add yourself.
Yeah.
But we also have then the external expansion for the Xbox.
The Seagate little memories card.
Yeah.
You can call it memory card.
What else do you call it right now? PS5 is going to be cheaper in the long run.
For the expansion.
Right now, PS5 is actually slightly more expensive at like $10 more for a 1 terabyte equivalent.
So the main issue is that on the Xbox, there's one option if you want to expand your storage. Now, both PS5 and Xbox Series X and Series S support USB hard drives, but only for older games. If you want to play a current gen game, you need that SSD. So for the Series X, you can get a 1 terabyte Seagate for, I believe, $220.
$220.
So that's the only option right now.
Only option, and probably, I only see it going up from here. I don't know if we're going to see a 512 for this.
Maybe, They have left it open, though, that they may make more.
And there's, theoretically, a third party could be open up to do something. But with a proprietary drive, the chances of this falling in price is pretty small. Like, you know, this isn't going to see massive price drops like we're going to see with regular PC hardware, which is what the PS5 can take advantage of. However, right now, only one model of SSD is available.
The WD Black, right?
It's WD Black, and it's like the newest PCIe 4. And
yeah.
The equivalent 1 terabyte is $10 more than this right now.
Now this is a little hard to compare because you're 100% right. They're going to absolutely create more SSDs over the coming year or two.
And that
they're certified.
And those prices are going to fall.
I will say a couple of things that I don't want to say are disappointing. You know what? I will say a couple of things that are disappointing about the Series X. So when you look at it beside the PS5, this is a Wi-Fi 5 device, whereas the PS5 is Wi-Fi 6.
Which is,
That's significant, I think.
Wi-Fi 6 is is popular enough right now that, yeah, it feels like they could have included that.
Yes.
I was disappointed that there is no 3.1 or 3.2 USB-C port on here.
Yes.
You know, like...
Sony's got it beat across the board.
Yeah, it's... Right now, we have just 5 gigabit USB 3s right here,
and
which...
They're all USB-A, and there's 3 of them.
Yeah.
Whereas on the PS5, you get not only a USB-C port, but you also get multiple 10 gig USB-A ports, yeah. Which, look, let's be real, I don't think that is the end of the world, because what are you really going to do with those?
Yeah, because it's that even with a 10 gig, you're still not getting the speeds that you would with the SSD.
You're not playing games on it, right?
But again, we're just thinking of where we're going to be in a few years.
Yeah.
What if there's a 10 gig? I don't know.
No. I think you're 100% right here. The idea is USB-C is the future, right? Every device is taking advantage of that. I get the concept that just like going from the 1S to the 1X and the 1X to Series S and Series X, they all have the same power cable. They all have HDMI in roughly the same place. They all have Ethernet. And they all have the same amount of USB ports, one up front, two in the back, right? I get the idea that if you're upgrading from any of these consoles, you basically plug and play. Although, one note, if you are using an HDMI 2.1 display, use the cable that comes with the Series S or the Series X, and I assume the PS5 as well. That is a faster cable. You can't just use your old cables necessarily to get that full 4K 120. So just a little heads up there. But I get the idea that you want to keep that continuity and you want to keep the hardware sort of very similar and easy to upgrade. But a USB-C port on the front would not have been the end of the world. And Wi-Fi 6, come on.
Yeah, it's... Come on. Especially if you're downloading these massive games, I would have liked to have seen like either a 2.5 or even a 5 gigabit Ethernet port. Like, I know my router is a couple years old, but I still have 2.5 gigabit ports.
I think that actually speaks to a really big difference between the Xbox and the PlayStation as far as where they spent their money and how, right? Yeah. So, of course, if you're looking at the apples-to-apples comparison, so the standard Xbox Series X and the PS5 non-digital, $500 each. The way they've gotten to that price is very different. There is no doubt in my mind, after seeing the PlayStation teardown and having physically torn down the Series X myself so far, this is a significantly more expensive console, right? So first of all, while yes, they may have saved a little bit of money on like USB-C and like Wi-Fi 6, the SoC on this is just simply bigger, right? The PS5 has a smaller chip with a smaller GPU. They are running it at like 110%. They're throwing all the power they can at it, taking advantage of stuff like liquid metal cooling, but it's a very simple design on the PS5, right? It's a single motherboard. They've got a big heat pipe. It is very much an evolution of the PS3 and the PS4 designs across the board. Right? Which is fine, that makes sense, right? But that is a cheaper solution. The Xbox Series X has dual motherboards with a mid plate. You have obviously the very expensive vapor chamber cooling, and there's a lot more. And of course the chip, right? The chip is physically bigger. It runs at a standard clock speed, right, which means that it is significantly more expensive just because it is a physically
baseline,
larger.
Yeah. There's no room for error with it.
Yes.
Yeah.
So with all of that being said, I think it's pretty clear that Sony, they might be making a couple bucks on their PS5 when they sell it. I don't think Microsoft's making a dollar on this thing. There's no way just with how expensive they've done everything on it, which is why I'm like, okay, look, a USB port here, Wi-Fi there. But seeing the two in contrast is really different because basically they spent all that money to not only get that sort of sustained performance, but also to get a smaller form factor. Sony, on the other hand, has basically gone with the same old school design, but bigger, right? Which means that it's a physically larger console with the same cooling technology inside. They could have made that smaller if they would have gone with like vapor chambers and whatnot, but instead they opted to save money, which nothing against that. I mean, consoles are expensive, but because of that, it is a much larger console because of the cost savings.
I just wish they had made it look different. I just don't like the way the PS5 looks. I'm not a huge fan of the green in here.
I
like the box. I don't know, like
it's an Xbox. So I'm curious, now that we're less than a month away from launch, How do you think the Series X is stacking up with the PS5 right now?
I think the Xbox is in a better place because, again, we still have barely seen anything with the PS5. I've gone on record. I think the PS5 is going to be soft delayed through bottlenecks.
You mean super low stock at launch?
Super low stock, like very small number of people are actually going to be able to get one. I don't think it's going to be mass available for, you know, until next year. Like early in next year. I'm not saying like, you know, a year from now, but like early into 2021, past the holiday season. The problem that I think is plaguing both of them is that neither one of them have a launch title for it.
I was about to say, these consoles have everything you need except games.
Yeah. Now, don't get me wrong. Just seeing, you know, and I'm sure it's going to be very similar on the PS5, but just seeing the One X games that have been optimized for Series X, the night and day difference of this makes me want to go back and replay some games that I never finished because of, like, you know, oh, whatever.
Like, I'm going to finally finish The Witcher and Middle Earth.
Yeah, just
Shadow of Mordor.
Seeing that little bit of improvement and just makes an overall better gaming experience, which I think is going to be great for both consoles. Obviously, PS5 has the more, I would say, dedicated fan base.
Sure.
So I still think it's gonna be poised to sell more right out the gate. But I don't think it's gonna be as much of a blowout as it was last generation.
It looks like it's gonna be a good time to be a gamer. And with that, it's a good time to subscribe to This Is. Thank you very much for watching. Make sure to stay tuned for more future console content. I hear that Sony PlayStation's coming out at some point in the next few weeks.
Maybe.
I'm probably gonna make a bunch of videos on it.
Maybe.
Matt, if we don't get a PlayStation 5 because your pessimism, I'm going to be so upset.
I think we're not getting a PS5 because we're not VTubers.